Hello everyone, welcome to StudyIQ. StudyIQ, in this video I will bring to you the current affairs of 14th of Jan. Let's start the video. Which of the following city has received the best Safai Mitra Surakshit Shahar Award at the Swachh Sarvekshan Award 2023? Now Swachh Sarvekshan, you have to do it in detail, okay? So I will tell you 9 to 10 questions which can be asked from the Swachh Sarvekshan. First of all, Swachh Sarvekshan was conducted by which ministry? The answer is Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. And for 7th year in a row, Indore is the cleanest city, but this time it is not alone. So the first position is shared by Indore and Surat. Indore and Surat. And Navi Mumbai is third. There is no city at second place because Indore and Surat, they are joined first. So Navi Mumbai is the third cleanest city in India. This I am talking about the among the large city or those cities which have a population more than 1 lakh. So cities were divided into two parts. Now here I am not asking that which is the cleanest city and all that, that I will cover definitely. I am asking best Safai Mitra Surakshit Shahar. Safai Mitra is a cleaner, sanitation worker. He should be safe. So which city in India has done the best work in making sure that all the cleaners, all the sanitation workers, they remain safe for their safety? The answer is Chandigarh. Chandigarh has received the best Safai Mitra Surakshit Shahar award. Very, very important. And now let me tell you which are the cleanest cities in India. Now here you can see cleanest cities more than 1 lakh and cleanest cities less than 1 lakh. So here you can see Indore and Surat are joined first. Navi Mumbai is third. You have to remember only the top three. And among the small cities, so we have this place called Saswad, which is in Pune in Maharashtra. It is the cleanest city of India, cleanest small city. Second is Patan. Now Patan, there is a place called Patan in Gujarat, but this is in Chhattisgarh. It is in Durg district of Chhattisgarh. So Patan, and third is Lonavala in Maharashtra. So Saswad in Pune, Maharashtra, Patan in Chhattisgarh, and Lonavala are the top three. Till here it is clear? Till here it is clear? Okay. Now which is the cleanest cantonment in India? Cantonment is the Mau cantonment, which is in Indore in Madhya Pradesh. Mau is the place where Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was born. Where Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was born, right? So Mau cantonment is the cleanest cantonment in India. Second best, second cleanest is Deolali. In fact, if you remember, Deolali cantonment last year, I think it was the cleanest. But this year it is Mau. Now, which is the cleanest town in India, which is on the bank of the Ganga River? So that is Varanasi. Varanasi is number 1, Prayagraj is number 2, Bijnor is number 3. But just remember which is at first position. So which is at first position? We have Varanasi at the first position. Till here it is clear. Now they can also ask you which is the best performing state in India, the cleanest state of India. If they ask you, Maharashtra is number 1, Madhya Pradesh is number 2, Chhattisgarh is number 3. You have to remember the top 3 ranks. You have to remember the top 3 ranks, which is very, very important. And now they can also ask you some other questions. So for example, when was the first time the Swachh Sarvekshan was conducted? So Swachh Sarvekshan is conducted by the Ministry of Housing Urban Affairs since 2016. Since 2016, right? And Indore is the cleanest city for 7th year in a row, but this time Surat has shared the first position, right? And they can also ask you about the fastest moving city. Now what is the meaning of fastest moving? Fastest mover or fastest moving city is that city which has the most improved sanitation compared to the previous survey. Now again, these are divided into two parts. The fastest moving city, one large city and one small city. Now here large city means population more than 1 lakh and small city means population less than 1 lakh. So in those cities which are a large city, the Panji, the capital of Goa, is the fastest mover. Among the small city, there is a place called Naurozabad. Naurozabad. Naurozabad is in MP actually. Naurozabad is a place in MP, right? Naurozabad. So Naurozabad is the fastest mover. It is in Umadiya district of Madhya Pradesh. Naurozabad is a city in Umadiya district of Madhya Pradesh. It got the award for being the fastest mover, for being the fastest mover, right? And cleanest Ganga town, I have told you, everything else is covered. Okay. Zonal awards were also given: East Zone, Cleanest City, North Zone, East Zone, West Zone. These are not important from national exam point of view. Shri Narendra Modi ji performed the darshan and puja in the Kalaram temple mandir. In the Kalaram mandir, where is this temple? This is located in Nashik in Maharashtra. And PM Modi also went to Shri Ram Kund on the bank of the Godavari River in Nashik, and he performed the puja there also. And the Kalaram temple, PM Modi himself, he cleaned the Kalaram temple premises in Nashik as a part of Swachhta Abhiyan campaign, where all the temples of India are being cleaned till 22nd of January. So the main deity in the Kalaram temple is the Rama, Lord Rama deity, right? In fact, in Nashik, we have this place called Panchvati, where Lord Ram, Lakshman and Sita, they lived here during their exile, right? So Kalaram Mandir is in Nashik. Also in Nashik, something very important has happened recently. What is that? Well, in Nashik, the National Youth Festival is taking place, 27th edition of National Youth Festival. The main event is taking place in Nashik, and the theme is Viksit Bharat at 2047 by the youth for the youth. Now, National Youth Festival is, basically a festival to commemorate National Youth Day, which is on 12th of January, the birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda. PM Narendra Modi has laid the foundation stone of the underground road tunnel that connects Eastern Freeway's Orange Gate to Marine Drive in Navi Mumbai. What will be the total length? Total length will be 9.2 km. So it's a brand new tunnel. It's a brand new tunnel which is coming up in Mumbai, 9.2 km tunnel, and it will reduce the travel time between Orange Gate and Marine Drive. Let me also tell you the most important project, of course, the Atal Setu. We call it the Sevdi to Nhava Sheva Atal Setu, named after Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and this will be India's longest sea bridge, right? So the foundation stone was laid in 2016 by Pradhan Mantri Modi. So it will be the longest bridge in India, the longest sea bridge in India, both 21.8 kilometer long. Right, out of that, almost 16.5 will be above the sea and the remaining over the land. It will connect Sevdi in South Mumbai. Then the bridge will be over the Thane Creek area, and then it will connect a place called Chirle, which is near Nhava Sheva or the Jawaharlal Nehru Port. So this bridge is now open for public, and around 70,000 vehicles will use this bridge every day. Very, very important question. This bridge is also known as what? It is also known as Mumbai Trans Harbour Link. Mumbai Trans Harbour Link. Understood or not understood? Now PM Modi also inaugurated the Surya Drinking Water Project. Surya Drinking Water Project will provide drinking water to Palghar and Thane district. So Surya Drinking Water Project will benefit a population of around 1.5 million in Palghar and Thane. And he also inaugurated a center for gems and jewelry called Bharat Ratnam. Bharat Ratnam. It was inaugurated at the Santa Cruz Electronic Export Processing Zone, which is a special economic zone for gems and jewelry. So all of these are handy things you should know. And this is the Atal Setu. Look how gorgeous it looks, no? Atal Setu. Union Minister Mansukh Mandaviya has inaugurated the permanent campus of NIPAIR, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, in which of the following city of the Northeast? It was inaugurated in Guwahati. Now, if I ask you how many NIPAIR are there and NIPAIR works under which ministry? So, National Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, also known as NIPAIR, they are world-class pharmaceutical education institutes, and they work under the Department of Pharmaceutical, which works under the Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizer. So Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizer. Now, how many NIPAIR are there in India? So in India, there are 7 NIPAIR. NIPAIR, we have a NIPAIR in Mohali. We have in Ahmedabad, Guwahati, Hajipur in Bihar, NIPAIR Hyderabad, NIPAIR Kolkata, and NIPAIR Raebareli. So these are the seven NIPAIR in India, right? So NIPAIR Hyderabad and NIPAIR Raebareli, they are also permanent campuses are being inaugurated recently. So NIPAIR Hyderabad and NIPAIR Raebareli, their permanent campus foundation stone was also led by Mansukh Mandaviya, and he also inaugurated the permanent campus of NIPAIR of Guwahati. This is the only repair we have in the Northeast. Absolutely clear. So NIPAIRs are very important institutes, pharmaceutical education and research. So the first time NIPAIR was set up, it was in 1998, that was NIPAIR Mohali. So NIPAIR Mohali was the first NIPAIR in India, and it was set up in 1998 by the Ministry of Chemical and Fertilizer. There are seven NIPAIRs in India. Which of the following High Court has allowed the Katil Durga Parmeshwari Prasadita Yakshgan Mandali to resume all night shows? Yakshgan. So Yakshgan is a folk art of Karnataka. So Karnataka High Court has allowed the Yakshgan performance throughout the night. Recently there was a case, because of the noise pollution, the Yakshgan should not be allowed in the night time, but court has said that it will be allowed throughout the night. Yakshgan basically is a folk art. There are dance performance, there is music, and the talented artists, they perform, they take the tales of mostly Ramayana or Mahabharata and they perform it. So it's a very, very important folk art of Karnataka. The Mulya Pravaha version 2 guidelines, they have been issued by which organization? This is the University Grants Commission, UGC, Mulya Pravaha guidelines. Now earlier we had the Mulya Pravaha guidelines in 2019. So this is the second part. Basically what they want to do is they want value-based institutions, who teach values, fundamental duties, constitutional values, national bonding, ethics, harmony, brotherhood, commitment, sustainability, respectfulness, inclusiveness. So Mulya Prabha guidelines are for the higher education institution, and they should make sure that integrity, accountability, all of these qualities that I mentioned should be a part of education. There should also be no gender discrimination, sexual harassment, lack of confidentiality, gender discrimination, etc. in the higher education institutes of India. And UGC works under the Ministry of Education. So you can see Mulya Pravaha 2. These are the qualities that we want in our education. Which of the following organization has launched the Anubhav Award Scheme? Anubhav Award Scheme has been launched by the Department of Pension and Pension Welfare, and this department comes under the Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pension. Anubhav Award. What is the meaning of Anubhav? Anubhav means experience, right? So let's say a government servant is about to retire. How can he contribute? Well, he has experience, no? So all those central government employees or even the pensioners who have already retired, they can submit their Anubhav write-ups. Anubhav experience write-ups. So they can do so. Let's say this is the retirement age, which is mostly 60. They can do so 8 months prior to the retirement age or up to one year after the retirement. So they have got a window of 20 months, 8 months before retirement or up to 1 year after retirement. And their write-ups will be published. They will be first assessed how good they are, and then they will be published by different ministries or departments. So that is the Anubhav write-ups. So these Anubhav essay or write-ups are about how we can make the things better, how we can, because these people have spent considerable time in government service, so they know ins and outs, and we will make a better nation with their Anubhav or experience. So Anubhav awards will also be given to the best Anubhav write-ups. In terms of weightage, what is the rank of India in the MSCI Emerging Markets Index? So remember, our rank is second. Number one is China, number two is India, and number three is Taiwan. Emerging Market Index shows the most promising emerging markets in the world to invest in. It will help the investors to pick and choose which country do they want to invest in. So India's weightage has now surpassed Taiwan. India is only next to China. Here you can see this is the China, this is the line of China, and India has taken over Taiwan. This green line is of Taiwan, this red line is India. So we are now the second most favorable country to invest, second best country to invest, right? This shows our rising weight in the world. Rising weight in the world. Is that absolutely clear? So China's weight, you can see China's weight is somewhere here and it is decreasing. Here you can see China's peak was here around 40. Now it is somewhere around here, less than 30. Less than 30. So China's weight is now 26.6%. 26.6%, right? And what is India's currently? India's is somewhere here. It is less than 20. It is around 17.1%. So India's MSCI Emerging Market Index surged from 7% to 17.1% in the last 8 years. Malkangiri Airport has been inaugurated in which state? So Malkangiri is a place in Odisha. The answer is Odisha. This airport has come up in a place called Nilimadi. Nilimadi in Malkangiri. It is spread over an area of 233 acres. It's a very large airport. But so far only small aircrafts will be flying from here. Not very big. Right? So this is the 7th airport of Odisha. It has been established by Airport Authority of India. It is owned by the government of Odisha, but it will be operated by the Airport Authority of India. And it has been set up under the Udan scheme, Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik. Now, which are the other 6 airports? This is the 7th airport of Odisha. So the other 6 are Bhubaneswar Airport, Jharsuguda, Koraput, Kalahandi. So in Kalahandi, we have the Utkala Airport, which was inaugurated recently. We also have an airport in Raurkela in Sundargarh district and in Ganjam also. So these are the 6 airports in Odisha. Now also there is a Govindapalli irrigation project which has been inaugurated on the Saptadhara river in Malkangiri by Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik. Govindapalli irrigation project across the Saptadhara river in Malkangiri. Is that clear? And also we will be having Bhubaneswar Metro. Bhubaneswar Metro will be 26 km long and it will go from Bhubaneswar Airport to Trishulia. Bhubaneswar Airport is the Biju Patnaik International Airport. So from there to Trishulia, Bhubaneswar Metro. Which of the following state government has launched a scheme called Lakhpati Baidev Scheme as a part of Mukhyamantri Mahila Udyamita Abhiyan? Mukhyamantri Mahila Udyamita. Udyamita means entrepreneurship. See, we want the women to start a small business. Small business means what? Micro enterprise. And for that, we are ready to give them money. How much money? If they have to submit their plan, like what is their business plan, what do they want and all. So they will be offered bank loan. In the first year, they can take 10,000 rupees. In the second year, 12,500. And in the third year, again 12,500. So if you add this up, so as you can see, 35,000 rupees total will be given to 40 lakh rural women entrepreneurs as a part of Mukhyamantri Mahila Udyamita Abhiyan. And what do they want to achieve by this Abhiyan, this campaign? They want to make sure that these women who start the business, their annual income is at least 1 lakh rupees. Or in other words, we want to make them Lakhpati Didi. In fact, PM Narendra Modi has a vision of making 2 crore Lakhpati Didi in India. 2 crore women should be Lakhpati Didi. So Lakhpati Baidev is a scheme started by Assam. The answer is the government of Assam, Hemanta Biswa Sarma. He said that I want to empower the women so that they can have an annual income of at least 1 lakh rupees annual. But there are some conditions. Conditions are like, for example, the woman should not have more than 3 children. The woman should enroll their girls in school. The woman should plant trees under the Amrit Briksha Andolan. So certain conditions are put. Which of the following country has launched the IGS Optical 8 Information Gathering Satellite, Optical Reconnaissance Satellite? It has been launched recently by Japan. It is a information gathering satellite, right? And it was launched through which rocket? The rocket is called H2A. H2A. So this is a rocket made by a Japanese company called Mitsubishi Heavy Industries. Mitsubishi Heavy Industries, right? So do remember that. And this is a project by JAXA. JAXA. But they will be using the rocket H2A by Mitsubishi. Just remember the name of the satellite, that's good enough. There is an exercise, Sahyog Kaijin. It was held recently between India and which country? So this is done by the Coast Guard. It is not done by Army, Navy or Air Force. It is done by the Coast Guard of India and Japan. The answer is India and Japan. Now it was done just off the coast of Chennai in the Bay of Bengal. Just off the coast of Chennai, right? Moving on. The Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, IIT Madras, Guidance Tamil Nadu, and which company? They have signed a MOU to establish a Hydrogen Valley Innovation Hub in Chennai. Hydrogen Valley Innovation Hub will be set up by IIT Madras, Guidance Tamil Nadu, and Hyundai Motor India. Hyundai is a South Korean company. The parent company of Hyundai is Kia Motors. So what is Guidance, this thing, Guidance Tamil Nadu? This is the, Guidance Tamil Nadu is the Investment Promotion Agency of Tamil Nadu. Investment Promotion Agency of the Tamil Nadu government, it is called Guidance Tamil Nadu. So Hydrogen Valley Innovation Hub project, the total cost will be around 180 crore and 100 crore will be invested by Hyundai Motor India, right? So IIT Madras will take the responsibility of setting up the hub in Chennai at in their own campus. So it will be set up in the campus of IIT Madras itself. They will do the research on hydrogen fuel and, you know, all of these. Basically, IIT Madras, they have developed a alkaline seawater electrolyzer technology to generate hydrogen. So you break down the water into hydrogen and oxygen and generate hydrogen. So this technology, you do the electrolysis of water. So alkaline seawater electrolyzer technology has been invented by IIT Madras. Is that clear? Another very important question. Which of the following has been recognized as India's first dark sky park? India's first dark sky park is Pench Tiger Reserve, which is in Maharashtra. Now be careful, because Pench Tiger Reserve is spread in Maharashtra as well as in Madhya Pradesh. Pench Tiger Reserve is located in Sioni and Chindwara district of Madhya Pradesh and in Nagpur of Maharashtra. I am talking about the Pench, which is in Maharashtra in Nagpur, right? We call it the Indira Priyadarshini Pench National Park also in Maharashtra. That is where India's first dark sky park has been set up. And what is the meaning of dark sky park? Basically here telescope will be put, night observatory, a telescope will be put near a place called Bagholi in Pench Tiger Reserve, and you can do star grazing because it is absolutely dark. There are no lights, there are no artificial lights also which disturb your view. You can watch galaxies, you can watch cosmic things, you can watch asteroids. Absolutely dark is there. And recently in India we set up a dark sky reserve, India's first dark sky reserve, in Henle in Ladakh. So this is a part of the Changthang Wildlife Sanctuary in Ladakh, right? So this was also set up recently. India's first dark sky reserve is Henle Dark Sky Reserve. India's first dark sky park is Pench National Park in Maharashtra. Which organization is giving a loan of $500 million to Gujarat for development of rural roads? It is New Development Bank, also known as BRICS Bank, and it is headquartered in Shanghai. So they are providing $500 million for the development of rural roads. Rural roads are being constructed in Gujarat as a part of the Mukhya Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. Mukhya Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. Is that clear? Who among the following has become the first bowler to take 150 wickets in the men's T20 international cricket? What is his name? So the first bowler to take 150 wickets in men's T20 is Tim Southee. And Tim Southee is a bowler from New Zealand. So he did it against Pakistan recently in a T20 match which happened in Auckland. So Tim Southee, who was his 150th victim? It was Abbas Afridi. Abbas Afridi, the Pakistan player, was his 150th victim. Shakib Al Hasan is at second position. Rashid Khan from Afghanistan. Shakib Al Hasan is from Bangladesh. And Rashid Khan is third in the list so far. And recently, there is another bowler called Nathan Lyon. He was in news because he picked up his 500th test match wicket. 500th test match wicket. DRDO, they have conducted a successful flight test of the new generation Akash missile from the integrated test range Chandipur off the coast of Odisha. It is a type of what missile? So Akash is a type of surface-to-air missile. It is a type of surface-to-air missile. Akash and Trishul, these are the two missiles in India which are surface-to-air, right? And it can strike a target at a distance of around 60 km. And this missile was made by which laboratory of DRDO? It is called DRDL, which is based in Hyderabad. Defense Research and Development Laboratory, which is one of the laboratories of the DRDO. Right? Of the DRDO. Is that clear? It has a 90% kill probability. So it's a very accurate missile. Who among the following is the author of a book called An Uncommon Love? The Early Life of Sudha and Narayan Murthy. This is about the love story of Narayan Murthy and Sudha Murthy. It is written by Chitra Banerjee Devakaruni. Just remember Chitra Banerjee, that is good enough. Okay. Earlier her name was Sudha Kulkarni, but then she became Sudha Murthy after she married Narayan Murthy. And they started the company Infosys. And Bhupender Yadav has released a book called Modi, Energizing a Green Future. So this book is published by Pentagon Press in collaboration with Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Research Foundation. Basically, this book is about how PM Modi is building a sustainable future for India, eco-friendly future for India. So here you can see some people who have contributed: Vivek Devroy, Mr. R.K. Pachnanda, Anirban Ganguly, Uttam Kumar Saha, Uttam Kumar Sinha. All of these people have contributed. This book is Modi, Energizing a Green Future. That was the video for 14th of January. I'll see you in the video 15th of January. Thank you for watching Study IQ.